So do we know all the buzzwords and have we seen them before? So who knows what a blockchain is? Okay, good, good, good. I will still explain it a little bit, but nice to see. Property-based testing, have you seen that before? Equal amount, so okay, fine. I don't have to talk anymore. We have all the buzzwords covered. Okay, now, so what I'm going to talk about is a project we are involved in since November. It's the Eternity blockchain that QWIC helps building and testing. And we are asked to test this blockchain because it's hard to test blockchains, apparently. But also because Eternity is writing the blockchain in Erlang, and it's an open source project. So it's a really, really cool and blockchain in Erlang. And we happily contribute to that. Since we have been testing it, I can tell you there have been errors found in it, and they are fixed. Which is probably we have the highest bug rate found of all the blockchains, which tells something about our quality as developers or as testers, right? So you make up your mind. So what is a blockchain? A blockchain is basically a data structure in its simple form. And of course, the difficulty is in the details. The devil is in the details in this case. But you have a record of transactions, of things, of people sending tokens to others, and then you want to have a record of that. And the record is not in the state of your node, but it's basically kind of a list. Alice owns 150 tokens, and Bob has 15, and Charlie has so many tokens. That's the kind of things which are in the state. And in the blockchain, which is done, is a record of that, how you came to that conclusion that Alice still has this much in her account. And it's a distributed network. That's where Erlang comes in nicely. So you have different nodes, and they all have their own copy of the blockchain. That's basically the ID. And then they send each other transactions and blocks all the way. So that's going on all the time. And what is really, really cool is that you cannot trust anyone. So I come from a background where you make a data system, even a distributed system, and you can always kind of trust the other nodes in some sense, that they do the right thing, that they are made by yourself because you probably have made the node, or at least someone you have a legal relationship with is not going to screw up completely. But here, the game is to write such a node yourself, talk to this one, and try to get money, right? That's the whole game. Try to fake that you are kind of a trusted party, or try to get money from that other side. And of course, you want to prevent that to happen. Okay, a blockchain. What is happening in one of those nodes is the following. You have your state, and you get a lot of transactions from people that want to do kind of switching tokens, payments, whatsoever. All those accounts are kept here, and you update your state. But before you can do that, you have to agree with all the others in the net that those are the transactions you actually take care of at this moment in time. In order to do that, you have to kind of say, these are the transactions I want to put on my blockchain, I want to take. And may I do so? You have to agree with the others. And our blockchain here, the Eternity blockchain, works with a kind of a proof of work where you do solve a little cryptographic puzzle, and that takes some time, and it has to take some time. When that puzzle is done, you have a solution of the puzzle, and together with the block, or the transactions, and the current state of affairs, you put the hash on your blockchain. So you only have to put transactions and hashes here, and the proof of work showing that, yes, indeed, I solved the puzzle, and yes, indeed, these are the transactions, and it's a hash, so that's unique. If you do the same thing as I did, you should have it the same state, and then we all agree upon it. That's a blockchain in a nutshell. So you get a number of transactions in, then you solve a puzzle, a cryptographic puzzle, which is different puzzle all the time and different difficulty, and then you send the hash of the things you have done, and you have the next block on the blockchain. As simple as it is. Now, it's a distributed system, so what happens then is that this block that you just kind of, the terminology is mined, you mine the block, this block has then to be distributed to all your other distributed nodes, and all those nodes, they receive that block, and they don't just put it on the blockchain, because you could have put some transactions in that block that make you very, very rich, right? That's the whole game. If this one mined the block and makes himself much, much richer, so you have to verify that that's not the case. You have to verify that all the rules, the proof of work is correct, that everything happens there is correct and that it fits upon your block. And you do that by some relatively cheap computation. So testing that the puzzle has been solved is much cheaper than solving the puzzle. That is just milliseconds or microseconds to just check it, whereas it takes a longer time to actually solve the puzzle. And there you are. The whole network is in sync again, and we have the new block distributed to everyone. One error in my animation, the chain is not shorter, it just copied the block. But it was late yesterday. So what could also happen is that at the same time, two of those nodes kind of mine a block, completely kind of okay. They both solve a puzzle of a number of transactions, and they are more or less at the same time having this block. And then they believe that that's the next block, and they are sending that then to their peers. And for example, this could arrive slightly earlier to those peers, whereas this is not yet sent to the other peers, and this one sends it to this peer, and this peer then has to decide, does it fit? And it might fit, actually. This block might fit, but then they send the other nodes the thing as well. Now we have a conflict, because this node now says, no, this block will fit on this one, but actually I already fitted this one. Whereas this set is actually the same. It says, this block and this block, they fit. This one fits as well, but which of the two do I have to choose? Now, and then every block has a certain value. So if it is a valid solution, if it is invalid, you just throw it away. You would not even have put it on the block. But if they both are valid, but just the timing, probably network split, the thing arrived a bit late, then you have to decide which one to throw away. And that's what they call a fork, in some sense. You have two blocks which both fit, and you have to choose which is the heaviest fork. You cannot decide that upon just one block, so you have to keep each of those two has more weight because there's more transactions in it or more difficult puzzle or whatever. So you can deterministically say which of the two you want to take, but you cannot really just put it on because the other one you still have to keep a number of blocks because it might be that you get three more blocks from this guy and none of them from this one. So you will then say, okay, the green chain is now going to win, so I only take my green blocks on top of it. So that's the kind of the basic idea of blockchain. You have distributed nodes, you make this long data structure, and you keep your state internally. And that's what happens. Okay, now the testing challenges then, if you have such a system. It's a complex distributed system. So you have the usual challenges of infinitely many possible states, right? Because you have all those nodes running, and they all can be in different states. Your messages can arrive in any order. It's not non-deterministic, that's the wrong word probably for it, but you don't know in which order things arrive and you still have to come to a certain conclusion. The nodes can decide themselves which transactions they take in the next block, so you don't really predict everything. So, for example, synchronization of a lot of nodes is a difficult thing to test. You can say, well, let the nodes run for a while and see if they agree upon the top block. But that's not necessarily always the case. It might still be correct not to be agreeing there. And how do you inject all the faults that can happen on the way? How do you make sure that you test it in all kind of different forking positions? You have a lot of different kind of transactions. This blockchain has oracle transactions, has contract transactions, spend transactions. So you have to make all kind of possible combinations of that. And it's cryptographically pretty hard to mock. So you cannot really mock blocks if you want to do that, because then you have to solve the crypto puzzles on the way, right? So you cannot really do that. So we do test in different ways. So how do we do this? We use quick check. And since many of you have already heard about it, it is generating tests instead of writing your tests manually. So we make a kind of a property and say the property should hold. And then you generate tests from there. QuickCheck in a nutshell, you write your property. From your property, you automatically generate tests until you find the test. You generate them and you execute them. The blue ones are passing. The red one is a failing test case. So you have randomly generated a test case which fails. What do you do? Well, you take that test case and you're now going to shrink that to the minimum test case that fails in order to have your debugging much easier. And I will show you an example in a second. So your minimum test case comes out of it, and you need to do that because you have a lot of noise in your test case that is not necessarily necessary to provoke the error. So that's quick check in a nutshell. 10 minutes, saw that. I will spend 10 more minutes. What we do, I will show you a little example of how this works. And then we have an API that we want to test. So the API under test is sending transactions to the node. And what will happen is you have a sequence of those randomly generated transactions. And the transactions are sent are creating accounts and spending with those accounts. So those are random transactions, but transactions that are, let us say, legal transactions. So it said, indeed, this could happen on the chain. So I'm going to make test cases later on in an example, and I will find a failing test case, and then I will show you how this is shrunk to a minimum test case, which is a minimum failing case for specifically that example. And I think I have a time for a 5-minute demo, and then we conclude. So I have prepared this here, and I can give you some examples of the test cases that I make with my quick check model. So an example of a test case could be this one. I hope it's readable from the back, but I will read it. So there is one guy with, or girl, whatever, with a lot of money, and that one can distribute that money, and that is what they call create an account. So there's a patron, and the patron can create an account for Charlie and puts 84 coins on it, and the fee that the patron has to pay is 2 coins. So now Charlie has an account with 84 coins on it. Then Charlie is going to pay 46 coins to Charlie and pays a fee of 4 coins for that. And this is how things can conclude. This is one randomly generated test case. I can generate another one. That's an empty one. That's also a good test case. And then we have a short test case here we generate, and et cetera, et cetera. So we can generate all those test cases. Let's also use them for actually testing the system. So I start quick check and I run my tests. And what you see, and I will try to scroll up a little bit, but we'll do it automatically. So let me go up. So I started quick check. I found this failing test case, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 commands long. This failed, and it's a bit hard to kind of analyze that. And I got the wrong balance in the end. And then I shrink that to another test case, which says, if the patron creates an account for Alice with 0 on the account and a fee of 0, then I get a fee too low. Right, that's an error message I get back. So the account is not found later on. So I cannot find this account. So it's from a completely different kind of failing case. It shrinks to a test case which is much smaller, which I have to fix first. So I'm going to fix this test case first. And the reason why this fails is that the fee that I provide for doing this is 0. And none of the miners will ever work for 0 fee, right? So they don't even put the transaction on the chain. So we have to fix that. And I, in this case, fix that in the model. Here's the model. And here I create my account. This is the amount I put on that account. And this is choosing a fee. And the fee is chosen between 0 and 10. Let's take it slightly larger here. Let's say a fee between 1 and 10. Then at least it's not 0. So I have to recompile the code. Oh. This is the hard part, typing. Yep, now it's recompiled. And then I quick check it again. And then I will scroll it up a little bit because you can't see it from the back. So there we go. So you see it has found, again, something where the balance is wrong. And then this would be a relatively hard job to debug, but it shrinks it nicely to this case where a patron creates Charlie, because we need an account to spend. It puts 2 tokens on it. Charlie pays 1 token to itself, and it has enough money because it also has to pay a fee of 1. So then Charlie should be at 0, right? Or, wrong, at 1 probably. But no, Charlie actually is at 3. This is a way of making money. Yeah, so you pay yourself 1 token if you have 2, and now you have 3 tokens. Brilliant. So keep this in mind. I will point you to the error, which is not complete. This is completely made up. We never had this in our chain. So let's see what happens here. Is that if the accounts are the same, the to and the from account, then here we put in the we put the amount on the on the chain, right? So we first take the amount from the account and the fee as well, so the amount is, and then we take the to account and we just put the amount on it. That's it, right? Not very smart. So what we better should do is actually not allowing the from account and the to account to be the same. You don't want to transfer money to yourself. We could also put an if-then-else here and say if the account is the same as the one, then you just take the fee and that's it. Bad luck, you shouldn't have done that. But we are more friendly, we just react the transaction. So let me see if I can save that, because my mouse is gone. Yep, there we are. Now I have to recompile the whole thing, so I do it like this. And there we go. We check the same property once more, the same failing test case once more, see what it says. It will still fail, but now with a different... it still fails, but it says it has the wrong balance, right? Because the balance has not changed, and I think that the balance should still change because the model is not in sync with the actual thing what happened. So the what happens now is that I reject the transaction, but if I still want to run this little bit of code, then it will say, oh, you know, you're still thinking that you have the wrong balance. I will leave it there because we are running out of time, but this is the way that you restrict it. You have a very relatively simple property, which I will show you here, a set of simple properties. For all sequences of transaction, the total amount of tokens in this chain stays the same. That's a property, and that should hold. And the other one is that invalid transactions are not accepted on the chain. And too low fee, too little accounts, etc. They are not. They just stay in the mempool, and you will find them there. And that's the other thing that I checked. So if I would have run more tests, it would fail for this reason. And then you fix the model that this is actually an invalid one, and you take it out. So that's, in a nutshell, what we do. For eternity, we generate our test cases and hope to find tricky mistakes. And we do find several tricky mistakes deep down in the code by very simple properties. The whole model I showed you here for this kind of toy example is only 100 lines of code. But in reality, the quick check models are only a fraction of the total code of the blockchain.